hearing and understanding of these words. On Orcas Island, Washington, the local power company is called Orcas Power and Light. The frequency with which significantly long power outages occur due to fierce winds, blowing seas, and human error has caused the locals to rename the utility Occasional Power and Light. Yet even in the face of such dubious reliability, faith in the always there-ness of something as basic to our needs as electricity is hard to topple. During power outages, residents find themselves automatically reaching for the light switch or putting something in the microwave. And admit it, you've done the same thing yourself. I know I have. Of course, there are technological helpers in whom we are very hesitant to have complete faith. You're checking out my picture. I'll explain that more later. Who hasn't learned the hard way never to forget to make a backup file on the computer, just in case the machine decides to eat that 65-page document we just entered, especially if you're a student and the paper's due the next day. In my case, I decided a long time ago it was probably a smart idea to print my sermon out on Saturday, just in case the power was out on Sunday morning. But actually, now I have it a little better, because I now have a laptop. So if the power goes out and I didn't get it printed, I can bring my laptop. Unless the battery's dead, which I tend to keep in charge. But in general, it's easy for us to have faith in those technological advances that make our lives so much easier, more comfortable, more efficient, and more self-sufficient. How ironic, the easier it becomes to have faith in the technological world of things that humans have created, sometimes it seems the more difficult it is to have faith in what God can do for us. Having faith is not nearly as comforting as having proof. Living by faith is far more frightening to us than living on credit. Stacking our futures and God's promises sounds riskier than investing our future in the possibilities promised by some technological gadgetry. To have faith and to live by faith may have been okay for some old wandering Aramean with no mortgage or car payments, no deadlines, and no children. But we see faith as far too shaky a basis for our own complex, often difficult lives. It's easy to point to those few among us who have based their movement through life on faith and see nothing but failures and frustrations. In spite of what you hear on some Christian networks, to live by faith doesn't mean that every wish will be fulfilled, every prayer answered, or that you'll always be successful. Issues of faith and the act of faithfulness were central concerns for the author of the book of Hebrews. The word faith is used more often in this letter, in this epistle, than it is in any other book of the New Testament. Here in chapter 11 alone, the phrase by faith is used 19 times. This entire unit is almost entirely focused on what has occurred by faith through the history of God's people. Today's lectionary reading from Hebrews picks up the author's definition of faith in the first few verses before it skips ahead to the example of Abraham as one who lives out that faith. The definition provided by the writer has two parts. First, faith is the assurance of things hoped for. Faith is what gives us the belief, as the believer, the conviction that the future will be as God has promised it to be. Indeed, it's in faith in God's promises that enables us as the faithful even to envision that unrealized time that we call the future. And second, faith is the conviction of things not seen. Faith in the promises of God enables the faithful to believe not just in some vague divine plan that's out there somewhere, but in specific events, people and occurrences that are in no way visible to us in our present time and place. All faith, according to the writer's definition, is completely dependent upon the validity of God's word, God's promises for sustenance. Two scientists were on a field trip in the mountains, and they discovered a baby eagle in a nest on a jutting rock, just below the top of a dangerous cliff. The eagle had been deserted, and they wanted to rescue it. They asked the young son of their guide if they could lower him on a rope to fetch that little bird. The boy wasn't at all enthusiastic. They offered him money, and then doubled it. But still, the boy refused. Finally, one of the scientists asked in desperation, "Well, then, how do you propose that we save this baby eagle?" The boy replied, "I'd be glad to go down to rescue the little bird for free if you'll just let my dad hold the rope." It's all about who we trust and who we don't trust. He didn't trust those scientists, but he knew that he could trust his dad to not drop him. The rest of today's lesson goes on to record a whole litany of those who have lived by faith. Yet it also makes it clear that for generations, those faithful patriarchs and matriarchs and their people never reached often their ultimate goals. Abraham's life of faith sees him out on a road toward a homeland that he never really gains. Sarah died after becoming a mother to just one child. And Isaac and Jacob were never really established in any way. The writer of Hebrews puts forward these early believers in order to give hope and encouragement to present believers. If God had made good on promises in the past, the text suggests, then why will God not continue to deliver on those promises today? God lives up to the promises that are made to us. But if living by faith doesn't mean you will live successfully, it does mean that you will live victoriously. Living victoriously by faith means that we can live secure in the knowledge that we may have absolute trust, complete confidence in the promises of God. It means being relieved of that death grip of panic and doubt that can freeze us from making any movement forward. It might not take away all of that fear and doubt, but it may give us enough belief that we can take that first step. Living victoriously in faith means that we're free to prophesy our way forward in life, empowered to work with every fiber of our being to participate in that prophecy's birth. Faith in God's promises and faith in God's continued presence. Faith itself is the victory. When we live by faith, there can be nothing less than a victorious ending. Where was the victory for Abraham? When he took that first step on his journey to Canaan and proclaimed God's promise. The rest was kind of commentary. Where was the victory for David? When he took that first step, bent down to pick up that rock and claimed God's promise. And the rest is commentary. The victory for Noah, when he took that first step and drove that first nail into the ark and claimed God's promise. For Moses, when he took that first step away from Pharaoh's family and joined his own people and claimed God's promises. For Joshua, when he took that first step on his march around Jericho's walls and he blew that first blast of air into that trumpet. And the rest was commentary on in the story. So we too must take that first step in faith. Faith is the victory. We must trust God enough to step out by faith instead of by sight. After Noah had built the ark, this is a little story. The animals started to board the ship two by two, as we've all heard. Pair after pair, the animals passed by Noah, heading up the ramp into the ship. Finally, a lone hippo waddled up, and Noah asked him where his mate was. "I was hoping to meet her on the cruise," and hippo replied, "That's faith." More than 30 years ago, I learned a song at church camp that about faith that has stuck with me. And I think I might have shared it here before, I don't even remember. And it says, "We are going, heaven knows where we are going, we'll know we're there. We will get there. Heaven knows how we will get there, we know we will. It may be hard, we know, and the road may be muddy and rough, but we'll get there. Heaven knows how we will get there." Frederick Buechner, one of my favorite contemporary Christian writers, said something similar. Faith is not being sure where you're going, but going anyway. A journey without maps. Those can be kind of fun sometimes, but they can be a little stressful. But if you don't know where you're going, wherever you go is where I guess where you're supposed to be. It was by faith that led me to go to seminary. How many years ago that is now, 20 plus years ago, despite my fears and doubts. Giving up my job and moving to the Twin Cities was really frightening. At one point, a few weeks into school, I even said to my roommate, I want to go back to doing what I was doing. I said that because I knew what was expected of me there, and seminary was kind of tough, and I was struggling a little bit. Taking that first step is a lot, is very frightening when you're headed into something that's unknown. Staying where we are feels easier because we know what to expect from where we are at this moment. It was faith that led the first congregation I served to call someone right out of seminary to be their pastor. It was faith that led me to agree to be the pastor at Soar UCC, where I have been helping to preach and do pastoral visits the last few months. They've seen me do two funerals already, so they know I can do funerals. One of them, we probably had double the seating capacity of the church, of people who were present. This is a church with no air conditioning. Thankfully, it was a beautiful 70-degree day with a nice breeze blowing through the building. You may have seen in the news, I think it was about in the last week or a little over a week ago, about a man who jumped out of an airplane without a parachute, and he landed in like a football-sized net. And actually, he was over to one side a little farther than he really wanted to be, but he got into the net. Personally, I think he was nuts. But he must have had a lot of faith that it could be done, and done safely, or he wouldn't have tried it. One of my favorite scenes from one of the Indiana Jones movies is from The Last Crusade. And it's where Indiana Jones, how many of you have seen the movie? So you'll probably know the scene when I get to it. Is he has to take that step off the side of the cliff, and it looks like he's going to drop, it looks like there's nothing there, and he is like, oh my gosh. He has to take this leap of faith. And so he takes that, and he actually, like, you see him, like, when he actually hits something, it's like his own surprise that he's landed. It was a giant leap of faith, but he did it and found that there was actually a rock bridge there that he couldn't see because it blended into the rock cliff around him. He took that step even though he thought he would fall to his death. And now to the picture. This picture was taken at senior high camp 4 years ago. Pilgrim Point has a partner relationship with a Lutheran camp nearby, and they have a high ropes course, and we use their high ropes course, and they come use our beach, because they don't have a lake access. And when I picked this picture, I didn't think, but I think that's Abby. I'm not sure, but she was there that day, and she was one of the girls that was up there, and that might be her. And when I picked it, I didn't choose it because that's who it was, but I liked it because this person has to take pretty big leap of faith in a lot of ways. I mean, to get between those two little pallet things, that's a big step. And they also have to have a lot of faith that their friends who are on the ground, you can't see them, that are holding the end of the rope, they're not going to let them fall if they miss and slip and fall. And then you also have to have a lot of belief in yourself that you can do it and try it. And I know that because I really wanted to do the zip line. I really wanted to try that. But I just couldn't get up enough courage to climb the pole to get to the platform to start it. I don't know if I could have gotten off the platform, maybe. But getting up the pole was the hard part. I don't like heights. I feel secure, but I don't, you know, I mean, I know that got hold of me, but I don't know if I totally feel secure. Plus, I was really selfless and let the kids go first. It's actually both. But yeah, you know, I don't remember what my reasoning was that day, but I sat there the whole day going, I really want to try that zip line. And I never did it, and I kind of regret that I didn't at least try to do it. In the resurrection light of Easter morning, it's by faith that we see the ultimate victory has already been won for us. Fatalists may view life as nothing more than an elaborate game of chess or chance, excuse me, where the luck of the draw or the roll of the dice determines everything. By faith, Christians know that the game is already won. The deck is stacked, the dice are loaded, the victory is ours because the promises of God are sure. Doesn't mean that there aren't fears, there aren't doubts, that things are always going to go our way, because they won't. But God is with us. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Faith helps those who trust and believe in God's promise to manage in the present when meaning seems sometimes far away. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. Amen.